Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I hope you're well and fresh after 2 days of work here at the annual meeting of the Global Future Councils. Welcome to this closing plenary. Time really flies. Closing plenary of the 2024 annual meeting of the Global Future Councils. I'm Mirek Dušek. I'm with the World Economic Forum. And we have a room full of members of the different Global Future Councils, and we have a few leaders of different councils also here on the stage, and I'll introduce them in just a little bit. And the function of this session is always to reflect a little bit on what we worked on over the past 2 days here in Dubai in the United Arab Emirates. But as you know, this is also a culmination of 2 years of work. So the 30 Global Future Councils that we have in the room here, you've worked together for 2 years. And you may remember in the opening session, we also said that not only is it these 2 years, but it's actually a very rich tradition of 15 years that we've been working with the UAE in this great partnership, convening global agenda councils and then global future councils around key issues that are shaping the global agenda. Allow me to just share with you a few things from our vantage points. First, we convene here over 500 leading experts from across 30 global future councils. We had started the first day with the launch of a custom-built strategic intelligence platform to support the implementation of We the UAE Vision 2031. And this platform provides AI-enabled briefings on 78 policy areas to better inform government decisions. We also, for the first time here, gathered six thematically relevant communities of C-suite executives, so really looking at business implications of emerging trends and putting them together with the Global Future Councils, and particularly looking at ways to improve workers' well-being, learning, and improve risk preparedness and economic forecasting. We have a council on the future of AI. AI was a big topic here at the summit. Some of the outcomes of the work we have here out of this meeting, a clear set of recommendations on AI value alignment to ensure ethical principles are integrated when AI technologies are developed and deployed. We also published a report, Governance in the Age of Generative AI, providing a framework and actionable recommendations for generative AI governance. And this was complemented by a white paper suggesting guideposts for technology policy rooted in the World Economic Forum's long-standing work on agile governance and digital trust. We also worked a lot here on climate and nature and also what it means for people. You may remember in the opening plenary, we talked about the Alliance for Clean Air. And so this, we have also a council on clean air. So this council published a report on clean air actions in cities, while a second report outlined here practical action to mitigate the impact of black carbon through a rapid action plan for global policy. Looking at financial inclusion, another report examined global financial inclusion practices, emphasizing the role of government policies, public-private partnerships, and technological innovations. So we also, throughout this meeting, spent time looking at the more fragmented and more contested geopolitical, geoeconomic landscape. And to support informed decision-making in this area, the Chief Risk Officer's Outlook, which is also a knowledge product, highlighted a range of global risks with the potential to threaten economic growth, further destabilize the geopolitical landscape, and disrupt broader business operations over the coming months. In the field of cybersecurity, the forum published and the council here a report underscoring the urgent need for a fundamental paradigm shift from security by design to resilience by design to mitigate rapidly evolving risks. As I also mentioned at the beginning of this meeting, it is a tradition that this gathering and the work of the councils overall informs the preparations for the annual meeting in Davos. So this is the case also this year. As you know, we've been floating around the meeting, the concept of the intelligent age. And I think Professor Schwab in his opening already mentioned that the annual meeting in Davos will be convened under the theme collaboration for the intelligent age. So this is just to share with you a little bit in terms of the outcomes, again, very select outcomes, some of the announcements that we made out of here in Dubai, and also, of course, again, as I said, a culmination from the work that you've done over the past 2 years. Now, let me turn to the distinguished leaders, thought leaders that we have gathered here for the discussion to really help us come to a close here after 2 days of work. I would like to first introduce them in no particular order. Eric Brynjolfsson, Jerry Yang, and Akiko Yamazaki, Professor, Director, Digital Economy Lab at Stanford University. And here you are co-chair of the Global Future Council on the Future of Job Creation. A warm welcome. Samir Saran, President, Observer Research Foundation, based in India, and you are here co-chair of the Global Future Council on the Future of Geopolitics. So warm welcome to you, Samir. Emma Fitzgerald, Independent Non-Executive Director, Seplat Energy, and co-chair of the Global Future Council on the Future of Energy Transition. A warm welcome to you. Megan Palmer, Director, iGEM, International Genetically Engineered Machine Foundation in the United States. And here you're co-chair of the Global Future Council on the Future of Synthetic Biology. And last but not least, just next to me, Khalfan Belhoul, you are Chief Executive Officer, Dubai Future Foundation in the United Arab Emirates, and a great partner of ours. and with a lot of fans in the audience.
I'll tell you why in a bit.
Tell me now.
Okay, maybe I'll start with it, because I wanted to first of all tell you, I mean, how proud we are with this convening that happens within the Global Future Councils, and how proud we are to be your partners in this effort. And I think it goes beyond the actual councils, and I think that's the reason some of my colleagues here and fellow members have been cheering, is because we agreed, based on what we've seen, that the relationship we've built throughout this council is going to, I know that WEF has decided that the metaverse tenor will come to an end, but this group will never come to an end. So we decided to continue this relationship, and so because, and the reason we say this is we think, I mean, it's all about the human connection, how you connect with the different personalities and the different cultures, and I think we've created that amazing camaraderie and kind of unity in that council, and credit goes to you. And I have to give credit to Judith as well, who ran our council from WEF. So if you can give her a big round of applause, I'll appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And Khalfan, I brought you in flexibly. I'll come back to you a little later. And okay. I like the organic nature of our conversation already. I'll go back to my script. If I could start with Eric Brynjolfsson, Professor. So obviously you are, I mean, I think everyone follows your writing over the years, and so you've published a lot on the intersection of technology and productivity. Now you're here chairing also the Council on the Future of Jobs. But first, on the productivity question, it's become again a very hot word in policymaking circles, for example, in Europe right now, with the Draghi report. That seems to be kind of the panacea. We need to close the innovation gap with the United States, and then we need to unlock through that these new horizons of productivity. But you've published on that intersection for a while, and so help us understand kind of your perspective on kind of your learnings from your research. What does it take in terms of, kind of tech adoption, and how does it translate to productivity in the economy? And then AI, is it a big deal in terms of unlocking exponentially more productivity, or is it more in line with the previous technologies that you've researched? Over to you.
Okay. Well, there's a lot there. Let me start with the end. So AI is I was just talking to Samir, is in many ways overhyped. Samir was telling me that. But I also think it's underhyped, and it's both at the same time, because people are very confused. They think of it as one amorphous thing. And one of the most painful things I see is when companies or whole continents think of AI and this is amorphous thing, and then they just throw money against it and say, oh, Where's the productivity? And that never works. And that's what we've been doing a lot the past few years. But there's an opportunity to be much more focused. And we've been developing what we call the task-based approach in some of the research we've been doing. My company, WorkHelix, does some of it, which breaks down economies into jobs and then jobs into tasks. A job is a bundle of tasks. And when you do it at that level, you can make much more headway, because you'll find that in almost every occupation, there are some tasks that can benefit from AI, and there are many other tasks that AI can't do anything at all for. And by distinguishing them and going through tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of distinct tasks, you start beginning to have a roadmap to where you can progress. The other thing that you learn is that it's rarely just the technology itself that works. It's the combination of the technology with changes in skills, workforce skills, with business processes, even new goods and services. And those complementary investments take time. They're difficult to make. Sometimes they even involve cultural aspects to it. One of the things that's also very painful to watch is the way that the EU and a lot of other countries have some brilliant people working on the technology and who could benefit from this, but they aren't putting all the other pieces together. And so you see in the past few years, the US has been pulling further and further ahead. And I don't think it's because they have better researchers or technology. It has to do with the complementary ecosystem, those skills. And so I think having a culture that embraces some of the dynamic change, the creative destruction, would do a lot to help Europe. And finally, the last point I'll just make is that it's been a real pleasure to co-chair Jan Eberle, the Council on the Future of Growth. And we've been focusing, especially the past few days, on low and middle income countries and the challenges that they are facing there as well. And there's really three aspects of AI that we've been focusing on. There's a lot of things we can talk about, you know, green energy, the demographics, some of the other changes. But when it comes to AI, it's not so much creating the AI per se that's the big opportunity. It's using AI to transform education, agriculture, professional services, many other aspects of the economy, and also using AI to help with matching of jobs and workers to those jobs in a more intelligent way and the skill training there. So those are some opportunities there where we can involve AI boosting productivity, not just what it's already beginning to do in the United States, but in Europe and I think in the entire rest of the world.
Just following up on that, in terms of the impact of AI on productivity, do you think that we will using it to optimize, or are they going to be using AI more to create new value? Where are you on that?
So I think there's too much of a focus on using AI to take out costs and to reduce labor costs and eliminate, and in many ways just optimize. There's certainly opportunities for doing that, and I wouldn't ignore that. But the bigger opportunities are into creating new things, especially with generative AI. It's often not entirely accurate. It can hallucinate. But if you keep a human in the loop, some of those can be features. You start identifying new kind of creative types of content and output, and even new ideas. So I know some people working on helping new scientific theories. So AI can help companies come up with new products, services, business processes. And that kind of combination of humans and machines to do new things that were never done before, as opposed to using AI to replace existing humans doing the things they're already doing, there's much more upside in that kind of additive, creative use of AI. And so I've been encouraging people to focus more on that. I think there was a lot of damage done to the field when Alan Turing put forward the Turing test, which is this iconic idea that the epitome of a good AI was one that was so similar to a human that you couldn't tell the two apart. And that, I think, captured the imaginations of not just science fiction writers, but a lot of AI researchers. But from as an economist's perspective, actually, that's the worst way to use AI. Not only is that a relatively low ceiling, I mean, I know humans are impressive, but AI could do a lot more things. But also, if you're using AI to replace humans, then it tends to lead to a substitution, drives down wages. Substitutes drive down wages, and it also leads to a concentration of wealth and power. While if you use AI to augment and extend what humans can do, then we can do entirely new things that I think will marvel us all, and it leads to a more widely shared prosperity. And I think that's the future most of us would prefer.
Maybe just two quick things to add. In terms of those, because you work a lot with industry as well in your research, when you really look under the hood of how particularly Gen AI is now being used in corporations. When you read about it, it's like a mixed picture. Some people are very optimistic that these co-pilots and other things are really going to augment us. In a year, everyone will be using it and being augmented. Others are saying that it's actually, the jury is still out and there is a lot of issues with that. So for example, on those co-pilots, do you see us in 5 years? Yeah. All of us using them very efficiently?
Well, so I wouldn't agree with either of those views per se. I don't think the jury's out. I think that what we're seeing is that there are some real benefits, but they play out over a number of years. We're not all going to be augmented and with co-pilots. I think that the past couple of years, I've seen a lot of companies experimenting with AI, and that was fine. But today, the time for experimentation is almost over. It's time to identify business value. There is a lot of low-hanging fruit. I've done studies with call centers where you're getting 35% productivity gains, especially the less skilled workers. In software and coding is another big one. If you do this task-based analysis, you can identify hundreds or thousands of tasks in most companies where there's a real potential for productivity gain quite quickly, and companies should be pivoting towards implementing those to start getting those productivity gains. And I think over the coming decade, we're going to see the highest productivity growth in those companies and in whole economies that have implemented the technology than we've seen in decades.
Great. And maybe just very quickly, you mentioned to me that you are also looking at new ways of measuring economic performance. Tell us
about it. Well, so in the 21st century, the world is changing so much, the age of collaborative intelligence. In this world, some of the things that we've been measuring in the past, you know, tons of steel, bushels of wheat that we could count with traditional GDP, are not the main sources of value in the 21st century. Wikipedia is something that's available for free, creates a lot of value, but because it has zero price, it has essentially zero weight in GDP. And there are a lot of other zero price goods, most digital goods, a lot of household production, environmental goods that are very important. So GDPB, the B stands for benefits, is measuring the value you get, not the cost you put into it. And we're going through right now, we've done it already for hundreds of digital goods, and we're doing it for a basket of the other goods to start seeing where is the value being created. And it's not the same places where the money is being spent. And this gives a much more meaningful visualization of what's really important in the economy. And as the 21st century becomes more and more digital, it's going to be more important to have this. I mean, just to give you a little metric of that, in the United States, the average American spends about 8 hours and 32 minutes looking at screens each day. Whether it's a phone screen, a computer screen, a TV screen, some kind of a screen. So already a little more than half their waking hours, they're consuming digital information rather than all the other goods and services. So we're increasingly in a digital world, and we need to have metrics that are suitable for that. And GDPB, I think, is the metric of the 21st century.
Great, thank you. Going to Emma Fitzgerald, if I can. Energy transition, another dynamic field. We had a chat just before. You said that, again, going back to the two-year term, you've been working with your colleagues for 2 years, but now you're looking kind of at a reality check of where we are with the energy transition. What do you mean by it? Help us understand where your minds are right now in the council.
Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here. I have to say that it's been a tremendous pleasure to work so closely with a very diverse and passionate group of people. I'm going to do my best to represent their opinions, but depending on exactly where we go in the conversation, I may choose to have an opinion of my own as well. So that's just a bit of advance warning to them if I go off-piste. But we talked a lot today, as we tried to draw the council together, about what we see as being the new face of energy transition. Tremendous amount has happened in this area over the last 2 years. When we set out, we decided to focus on three sort of work streams to see where we would go. One was on demand measures, because we felt that wasn't something that was being properly addressed. The other was supply chains, including critical minerals. And the other was an inclusive transition. So we wanted to make sure that Global North and Global South were being properly represented in our thinking. And we had a lot of great discussion around that. This morning, we were saying, so where are we today? And the reality check is that, bluntly speaking, we feel that it's really important to step away from talking about delivering 1.5 degrees or the sort of the specific targets that we're talking about now, partly driven by the fact that both the IEA and Goldman Sachs recently have effectively declared their view on the temperature increase. But more importantly, we wanted to say that means we need to have a different playbook. We need to think about this differently. And through those conversations, we've identified some areas that we believe are going to be absolutely pivotal to actually being able to mobilize faster action as we move forward. The first of those is the need for a systemic approach. Now, that may be stating the obvious, but the point is that at the moment, things aren't joined up. So on a governmental level, on a country level, we have NDCs, which have all been established in slightly different ways, may not be measured on the same basis, might include different assumptions. We have a lot of investment from private sector and other, but it's not necessarily explicitly linked to the NDC priorities and objectives. And that in itself means that the money's not necessarily going to where it needs to go. And one of the sessions I sat in on earlier, one of the C40 colleagues was talking about how money that they need for projects for their city work is not reaching them because you have that disconnect. So we would be saying there's a big plea around joint planning and joint scenarioing to make sure that we actually do that. And that also there's an increasing focus now on making sure that anything that is financed creates value and that we understand what that value is. And it's necessary to be able to show that value to attract funds. Another key trend that we've talked about is that the people in the room when these decisions are being taken need to change or have changed. Whereas a couple of years ago, there might have been a conversation driven in the boardroom by a CSO. It's now the CFO who's calling the shots. And there's a number of reasons for that due to some of the regulatory changes, etc. But that reinforces the focus on value, and it reinforces the need for the right narrative to demonstrate why these investments are essential. We're planning to do more on that in terms of capturing our thinking on that, because we see that as absolutely pivotal. And it's not just in the boardroom. If we're talking about governmental level, there are a number of instances where we know that responsibilities are passing between ministries. So where something might have been decided by the Minister of Environment, it's now the Minister of Energy or the Minister of Business. So again, getting the right people in the room to have the right conversation about where to focus precious resources. There have been a number of statistics that have been shared in the last few days, but for every dollar that goes into an African investment, $20 goes into an American investment.
Yeah.
That needs to flip. And how do we do that? And I'm not just talking about financing, it's just actually the mindset and understanding where the money will go for the maximum impact. The final thing that we wanted to highlight is the need for a common language. To bring all of this together, it's going to be really important that we're talking about the same thing and we're solving the same problem. It's really important that the metrics that we're using are the same. And so these are all the sort of focus areas that we will be continuing to champion and trying to mobilize action around to see whether we can actually speed things up.
Thanks so much for this great summary of the work of the Council. Maybe just two quick things to follow up. One, obviously we're reading a lot now how energy intensive AI is. But then, if, of course, there are people, then they say, well, but we need that because then we can, that can help with the, help us be better at the energy transition. Any thoughts on that, on the latter part, in what ways this can help us with the energy transition?
Sure. I mean, I think there are a number of ways that artificial intelligence can help us. If we think about this integrated planning approach, there's a way now of being able to integrate old data sources with new data sources to create new scenarios, which allows us to understand some of these interdependencies and also unintended consequences of some of the decisions that are being taken in isolation. And that's not just relating to energy. You'll have the linkage into water and other food, other aspects. That AI will help us to be able to do that in a more effective way. The other thing, which is perhaps less sexy, is we can actually model energy demand and we can give consumers insights which help them to understand precisely what they need to do every day to use less energy. Because at the moment, unless we can make it very, very relevant to people what they can do, it doesn't happen. So I think those are two key things I would say. The other point I'd make about data centers is it's really important, again, if we think about investments in data centers, there should be a requirement to think about what's the energy requirement, how will that energy be provided, and what is the water requirement as well, and making sure that you have a net zero impact on the energy side, and also you have sufficient water. So again, it's about using a different mindset to understand how to make sure you're deploying the right projects in the right places.
Finally, on when we speak about the intelligent age, we actually say this is whole sets of technologies that are moving exponentially. So we also look at advanced energy tech. It's a whole set, and of course, different headlines, etc. But anything from your vantage point, we should be paying attention to any specific technologies.
I mean, I'm sure many people will be aware of some of the sort of the higher profile technologies. So we obviously have things like CCS, offshore wind, solar, hydrogen, nuclear, etc. Those are all going to be an important part of the mix. But it will come down to the costs for implementation and making sure that the enabling infrastructure is in place to get it to where it needs to be. I think an area I would also highlight as being increasingly important, the one that needs to be talked about more, are technologies around carbon removal. Because if we come back to this point about the reality check and the fact that we're going to miss our targets, we are going to have to actually start removing carbon. And this is an area where there's a tremendous amount going on in terms of new innovations. We're going to need to get into the conversation around diverting finance to be able to support that. And that's quite a contentious subject, but I think it's going to be absolutely critical. So one to watch out for.
Great, thank you. Moving to Samir Saran. Samir, you are co-chairing the Council on Geopolitics. We talked here about a more contested, more competitive geopolitical landscape. A lot of people would associate that with the US-China relationship. But then what does it mean for the rest of the world? How do other countries have agency around shaping this new order? I know you've been working on some ideas around that in your council. Help us understand what they are.
Look, I think, so first of all, let me thank all the council members for the fantastic 2 years. I think we produced 2 council level reports, multiple agenda pieces, multiple external publications, podcasts, and of course we managed to meet each other in a number of different locations around the world. So I think this council is going to stay as well. And thank you for putting us all together. And we also realize that we don't agree with each other. So it's difficult to get the world to agree with anything. The world to agree on anything if 10, 15, 20 of us are so passionate about our positions. It's not easy. When in a room, you have such smart people with such innovative ideas for the future, we have to find the common path that all can sign on to. And in some sense, we got a glimpse of why it is difficult to agree on anything when you have 190-odd countries sitting in a room. So let me just talk about the point you raised. Look, the US-China rivalry has serious consequences. But we are not helpless. And the point that we were discussing was that perhaps the...
You said we are not helpless.
We are not helpless. Yeah. We don't have to wait for that to solve itself for us to attend to some critical questions that we need to attend to. Could be on climate, could be on tech governance, could be on SDGs, could be on a number of areas where people are crying out loud for some form of international cooperation and frameworks that can respond to those challenges. And there are countries who have agency and who don't lean on either of the two to make their decisions. Now, we started by coining a phrase, middle powers, and there was pushback. Why should we be the middle powers? Middle power is a reductive term, right? Big powers, superpowers, middle powers. No one wants to be the middle power. So in my mind, middle powers are those who hold the middle. They are not on either side. They are the ones who hold the center. The world needs for the center to hold, and these are the countries who can find that middle path that takes everyone along. And we thought that it is a time for a group of these countries to come together, put together compelling propositions around climate action, around tech governance, around peace and security, and a number of other areas which are crucial for us to build trust between those who govern and those who are governed in the international system, and a kind of a pushback against it by many constituencies around the world. So trust was important to be rebuilt, and certain verifiable, demonstrable action was required to be taken. For example, climate finance has to flow to the geographies where climate mitigation is required. Guess what? Climate future emissions are going to be in the developing and emerging world. So two-thirds of all emissions are going to come from there. Two-thirds of all global finances need to flow there. And unless you can have this very demonstrable movement of finance, we are all literally wasting our time on climate action. So in some sense, we were thinking about, and we came up in our last report that we produced for the forum, Shaping Cooperation in a Fragmented World, we came up with the idea of putting together this group of countries who have agency, who have voice, who have credibility in large number of constituencies to come together and frame the future, and then bring the big two to sign on to it and make it compelling for them to do so. So rather than wait for the G2 to come together and agree to a framework, I think it is time for the ones in the middle to carve that architecture. And by the way, we have seen at the G20, Indonesia, India, Brazil this year, and maybe South Africa next year, precisely do that. We've seen UAE at the COP28 come up with a framework for the future. So I think there are attempts already that are underway, and perhaps we need to institutionalize it, make it a grouping that meets regularly and produces these innovative ideas for the future that others will be compelled to sign on to, including those who don't agree to talk to each other. And I think that was the idea, that the ones in the middle put together a framework, get everyone to sign on to it.
Thank you. At the UNGA, just a few weeks ago, they had the Global Digital Compact, and people are putting particularly the agreement around the scientific body around the state of AI, putting it up as an example of countries agreeing that this is an important issue, and then they can collaborate. You can argue, of course, that there could be more things that could be done, but a lot of people are hailing it as really a great first step. But then on the other hand, of course, we do see these competitive juices around technology, how you mentioned G2 and other countries are trying to dominate these technologies for strategic advantage. I know you've been doing also yourself quite a lot of work on the intersection of technology and AI in particular, and geopolitics. Any views there?
No, so the Council had the opportunity to look at technology, specifically AI, on two occasions, in the first year and now in the report that's currently being prepared and should be released hopefully by the time the new president of the US is elected. So there are two thoughts here. One was that, is it time to put together a standing conference or a standing convening on technology that gathers every year? Because it's a fast-moving sector. It meets every year, appraises each other on their own learnings and lessons and of course, regulatory experiences, market experiences, et cetera. And in many ways, have a scientific body that you just mentioned, but also have a multi-stakeholder group that continues to engage deeply. And is it time to do that around technology? And rather than having these dispersed conferences, which are more about raising money and raising sponsorships, can we also have a convening that raises awareness and raises the level of solutions that we are grappling with? So that was one idea that we thought that maybe it's time to have that annual summit of innovators, of investors, of regulators, and of users coming together, knocking heads, and thinking about it. That was one idea. But the second, the more contemporary one was also a cautionary tale. That there was, without doubt, in many of our minds, a huge push by technology to connect the world. Hyper-globalization came through the digital and technological interconnectedness that we really experienced since the 90s, for example, right? And if we are so connected and so interdependent today, technology has a huge role to play. And we cannot take this for granted over the next two decades. If we have enjoyed the benefits of technology to be interconnected in the past three decades, we should not take it for granted. This might well become the arena of fragmentation of a few varieties, the political fragmentation, the G2 and others who want to carve spheres of influence. But there is a second trend that could be in many ways become apparent with the concentration of computing power and data infrastructure that the AI era will require. Will we be able to have the dispersed entrepreneurship that Industry 3.0 afforded so many small enterprises around the world? You created unicorns everywhere in the world. You built enterprises everywhere in the world. Now, when you require such large computing power, such large data sets to produce models that work for you, will smaller enterprises and smaller countries and smaller communities be able to be onboarded onto this next miracle? And I think we have to start thinking about processes and ways in which we leave no one behind as we chug forward. So let's not take the experience of the past for granted. The next 20 years will require a greater awareness as well as interventions. Let me just make it a point. But let me just also make another point. I think the golden age of AI and the intelligent age will, of course, will be based on innovation and technology and everything else that we all enjoy. But it's going to be undergirded by the golden age of social sciences. Mm. I think how we think about society, relationships, the human and machine interfaces is going to decide whether this is going to be a positive age or it's going to be an age with a lot of collateral impact. Mm.
Thank you so much. I'd like to go now to Megan Palmer. You are co-chairing the Council on Synthetic Biology. I think it was last year, was it, or recently that you had a knowledge product, synthetic biology, so what? And I think you try to really kind of capture for out laypersons that are curious, why should we be paying attention to synthetic biology? Help us understand that.
Well, we've been having some great discussions over the last couple days about the power of many technologies coming together to really transform our ways of life. And I think that biological technologies are going to be particularly important in many of these transformations and helping to deliver the types of societies we really want to live in, one of the ones that are safer, more secure, more sustainable. And I've had the great pleasure to explore a lot of these topics through the Global Future Council, not only over the last term, but the term before, so now 4 years together, and many of our council members are here. And we realized through this, including through the meeting last year, that synthetic biology as a term is new to many of you. So synthetic biology is a field that's developing the foundational tools and knowledge to be able to engineer biological systems. I mean, biology is the most amazing technology on the planet that predates us, right? It evolved us. It is already a distributed manufacturing platform that is inherently sustainable, that takes sunlight and air and sugar and generates really most of the things that we need in society. I would argue it's the original generative technology. And now, as a result of many tools, including its convergences with AI and being able to read and write and edit and evolve biological systems, we can now program these systems. We can partner with biology in new and powerful ways that are more predictable, that are more precise. And this is really unlocking an immense amount of value in not just operating, again, in the world of sort of computing, but really making. In being able to feed us, developing more resilient crops, in being able to develop more sustainable fuels and energy sources, developing innovative new therapies that we didn't even think were possible, in protecting our populations, right? None of us would be sitting here. We would still be dealing with the COVID pandemic were it not for the innovative new vaccines that are a result of decades of investment in foundational science and technology. It is also developing new materials that are able to produce less waste, biodegradable plastics, as well as new types of materials that have properties that are useful, right? You could imagine, for instance, everything from developing a bio-based cement to developing a spider silk that is engineered instead of, it's difficult to go after a bunch of spiders and get their silk, but you can take those genes and put them into a organism to help to produce a super strong and super light material and scale that up. And there's just tremendous value in this, right? Biology already touches every sector. And we really are beginning to see now an appreciation of the strategic importance of these technologies to all societies. So just to give you some statistics for just how big these bioeconomies are, it's estimated about 60% of the physical inputs to the global economy could be biomade. 30% of the sectors are poised to be disrupted through biotechnology. The total sort of economic value, direct economic value estimated between 2030 and 2040 is $2 to $4 trillion a year. That's only direct. So the indirect value is immense. And what is really exciting is to see so many different countries and collections of countries and regions come together to develop their national synthetic biology, engineering biology, and bioeconomy roadmaps. And they are all very different, but they have many similarities. So even just this morning, we had many of our council members share each of their strategies that they have been developing and what is unique to their regions. And also what is shared in common across all of these different groups. It's just an immensely exciting time to be working in this space.
Thank you so much. I mean, just two quick follow-up questions for quick reactions. First, if you can just help us understand what AI, we look a lot on on those convergences now. So what is AI practically doing to synthetic biology?
So we only need to look at, you know, in the last couple of weeks, we've seen Nobel on the capability to use many of them, to use these tools to be able to really supercharge many of the things that we've already done. So these problems, these foundational problems in the field, how do you take a DNA sequence and how do you predict the structure of the proteins that underlie all of those biological functions. That's beginning to be unlocked because of the complexities in just this space. One of the things we don't appreciate as much in biology versus other areas is there's often this discussion around data, right? Building models off of the data. Well, we've barely discovered the biology that is already out there. We can harvest all of this biodiversity, all of the things that nature has already invented for us, that then now if we can collect them, we can also use these tools to better understand them. And unlike other languages that are human engineered, where we're using these types of tools to sort of re-engineer and discover things that we already invented, right? Again, we didn't invent biology, biology invented us. And we have the capacity to use and unlock the power of these tools to discover, again, the most foundational technology on this planet and use it to partner with us to make more sustainable, secure, and really flourishing societies in partnership with the living world.
Thank you. And just one thing, a quick thing on the bioeconomy overall, biotech. We talked about it a little bit, the small yard high fence of Jake Sullivan, in terms of how you see the international collaboration around biotech. Is it now becoming more of a national security thing? And are you seeing decreases of that? Is the whole bioeconomy field moving into that small yard, or is it more nuanced than that?
So one of the exciting things about the field of synthetic biology in its genesis over the last 20 years is it's really been international from the start. So I'm here, my affiliation here is with the iGEM Foundation, the International Genetically Engineered Machine Foundation. This is a student competition, largely student competition. It's invited young people from all over the world over the last 20 years to use biotechnology tools to solve problems in their regions. And this has, by giving the tools and asking young people around the world to use these tools, it has led to now 65 countries, 100,000 alumni participating in this competition and solving problems both local and global. Now, it ends up that kids also grow up. and those kids are often now leading their national biotechnology strategies. And they realize, again, that these technologies are key to security. And there are these bioeconomy strategies. They use the term security, but it's exciting because it's economic security. It is also the security of the living world. And certainly it is national security, right? We are dealing with both extant threats from pandemics and climate change, and also trying to understand the power of these technologies to potentially contribute to those risks, but alongside developing innovative governance and policy solutions to anticipate, mitigate, detect, and really deal with many of these types of opportunities and threats at the same time to create the types of worlds we wish to live in.
Thank you so much. Khalfan Velhu, we've listened to thought leaders around different technologies, the UAE, and also you personally, you are at the intersection of how these are then actually implemented in the UAE, in Dubai. Maybe we can start just, there may be some people that don't know what the Dubai Future Foundation does. You can start with that. But then I would be very interested to hear from you in terms of the types of, or the approach to regulation that that you and your colleagues are having here to make sure that we strike the right balance between risks and opportunities.
Yeah, and thank you, Merrick, again, and great to be here with everyone. And maybe even before that, if you allow me again to thank the council members and maybe talk about the outputs that we have reached, even though, like I said, this council specifically, the tenor is coming to an end. We strongly and firmly believe that the metaverse is not dead and that the metaverse has basically maybe Gen AI has taken the spotlight and AI has taken the spotlight, but what we believe is there was so much excitement at that time. There has been a filtration of idea throughout the journey, and then obviously we were all busy with the Gen AI output. And currently we sit in a position where we believe there's a balance between how much we're going to extract value out of this digital world. There's still more patience on the quality of the hardware, the quality of the immersive experience, and what it could be used for. So our main outcome was to actually cherry pick a few ideas and a few sectors that we believe will still continue to be a priority for the metaverse, entertainment, construction. Of course, health tech will be something that's extremely important. So it's still hanging in there, and we still believe that, I mean, it will have its big say once the maybe the plug-in of AI comes into the story as well, and then we'll come back and we'll come back strong again with our council, and that's why we're still hanging in there. But that's so we'll keep on
a lot pushing. Of lobbying.
We'll update you once we get the end result. Maybe about DFF quickly. I mean, the best way to explain DFF is it's the Dubai and UAE's lab, and that's the best way I can say it. It's a test bed, and I talked with some of my fellow colleagues about it, and it gives you an idea of actually how our leaders think here in this country. When His Highness Sheikh Mohammed came up with the idea, it was actually through the World Government Summit. There was a small immersive experience that was called the World Government Summit, and it was a temporary structure, probably a quarter the size of this room. It was right outside this building here, and the idea was for delegations to come and immerse into a journey of the most important futuristic dialogues. And this was around 7 or 8 years ago. Mirek, I'm sure you remember that. You were with us. And this immersive experience would focus on specific topics, and it was the future of food all the way to AI and living in space and beyond. And it was one visit from leadership, and I remember His Highness going in from one door and leaving from the other, sending out a message and saying, the level of this conversation that has happened in this temporary structure and immersive experience shouldn't be confined to the 3,000 delegates in this conference, the World Government Summit. We should, one, institutionalize future foresight, think of a way that we should institutionalize it, and we should open it up for the world to become a platform that everyone can do something about it for the betterment of humanity. So this was what we call the seed he planted from a vision perspective. And then was the tough part, is that we had to figure out how this thing works, because it wasn't easy when you come up with, setting up a hospital or a car dealership or you name it, you'd usually do some benchmarking around. So this was hard to really benchmark. Fast forward now, 7 years from there, the way we work, and to your answer now, we focus predominantly on one, understanding or doing our best to really understand where the future is heading. So we invest in a best-in-class team that works internally, that does pure foresight. We connect with like-minded people all around the world, one of which is, of course, the World Economic Forum, because, as we know, to tackle all those future challenges, you really need connectivity, relationships, and working with like-minded entities. So we invest a lot in understanding the future in a collaborative and inclusive way. So a big chunk of what we do is knowing where the future is going. The second part of it is doing something about that. So, I mean, I'll gladly share our reports that we sometimes even disseminate jointly with WEF. And based on that, then we come up with a set of priorities on what we do. And due to the agnostic mandate of the Future Foundation, the future is not only the future of mobility, it's not only the future of biotech or the bioeconomy, it's all of the above. It's a matter of what do you do and what do you prioritize. And this is what we do. We then come up with sets of products, some of which will be investing in technology through a impact investing venture capital fund that we oversee. Happy to explore collaborations over here. We are very bullish on the R&D side, investing in research and development. We're super excited about talent attraction and connecting with academia. We have accelerator programs. So our mandate is very wide and agnostic, but it always ticks the boxes of where the future is heading and what's important to the human being wherever they were in the world. So horizon scanning, understanding in a collaborative way, then doing something about it in different ways and forms. The last maybe component of your question, which is the regulation, and given the humble experience that we've gone through in the past years, I mean, honestly, I hate to break the news that regulations will never be at par with the most recent innovations. It's just a matter of how narrow that gap is between what you set out as regulations and what is out there. Because if you try to amend your regulations for technologies that are available now, 2 weeks from now, something new will come up and you'll have to adapt and actually amend your regulations in favor to those innovations. So The key theme in this component for us is how do you create an agile component, and that's what His Excellency Mohammed Al-Gharghawi, maybe with Professor Schwab in the beginning, talked about agility. I think this is the secret sauce here, is agility. How can you really become so agile in your policy, in your adaptation, in your investing in technology, in your government to private relationships, in your sandbox mentality? How can you plug all those components together to create a system that will be agile enough to be the closest to the most recent innovations? So a new idea comes in, last drone mile delivery, for example. How can you create an area to test this? You get the aviation expertise, you get the private sector, you get the cabinet at a federal level to approve the legislations. You get the investment in technology, you get the researchers to be all in the same room, and you try to accelerate the process with a willingness to understand that this environment will always have a failure rate to it. As long as you ring fence that failure rate, and as long as it's not something that harms humanity, and you create a sandbox and a safe environment for it to be tested and deployed fast, this is the secret of being an agile government, in our humble opinion. But again, I say, with all those efforts, you will never be with innovation at the same level. You'll always need to be agile and ready for the next change.
Well, thank you, Khalfan. We are almost at time, but just to have one more question to you with a quick reaction. You mentioned it a little bit, but I know you work a lot with the government and with the employees. So how do you make sure, what is your approach to reskilling, upskilling within the government?
Yeah, I mean, when we look at the impact, and you mentioned the impact the bioeconomy will have on our economy, when you mention the impact Gen AI will have or the metaverse will have, I mean, we're talking trillions of dollars, and there has to be some shift, there has to be a change. So I think, I mean, the nature of humanity will always adapt to those changes. We have always adapted to technology. The only difference here is the adaptation needs to be much faster than before, because right now we're, in my humble opinion, connecting three big beasts together. You're looking at high-speed computers, you're looking at AI, and you're looking at robotics. And if you think about the magnitude of what can happen once those three components connect together, you really need to have an agile skill set, and humanity need to adapt to those environments. But I'll wrap up by saying the biggest issue, I think, is not about the adaptation. It has been mentioned, I think, several times, whether it's moving from one ministry to the other, whether creating a separate platform that can advise other organizations, whether it being when you spoke to His Excellency Omar in the first session, talking about the UN effort and the AI consolidated effort to come up with something global. I think the biggest challenge is how do we come up with this? And I even go back to the World Government Summit's convening when Sam Altman was online, and he was asked by the Minister of AI if there was one thing that you wanted to really deal with AI. And he was, for us, and his simple answer is you can YouTube it, he just said we need to all think of some kind of a convening or a platform that can get us all to come up with one approach that, and focus on the human side and not on country agendas or personal agendas. Obviously, this is easier said than done, but I think this is the ultimate goal if we manage, and there's no other way forward for this. I mean, given the impact that all those technologies have, businesses right now, and we've talked about this in the past, before we used to set up businesses and look at the businesses around it and the markets around it. Now, you set up a business on your app and you click a button, the world becomes your market. So you need this this global alignment. So the question is, how are we going to do this? And which platform will be strong enough for us to achieve that in a way that focuses on the human first?
Thank you so much, Khalfan. Thank you so much to all of you here on stage. We spent 1 hour together, and obviously we only had a few councils here represented, so I'm sure we could now go on, and there was so much richness in the discussions, but we will make sure we capture that in the documentation that will be coming out of this summit. So thank you so much, because this is, as I said at the beginning, this is the culmination of not only 2 days, but actually 2 years working together. The mandate of the councils will finish by the end of the year, so I know some of your councils will also still have some touch points toward the end of the year. Just to say again that, and you said it, we're very proud of the collaboration at the World Economic Forum with the UAE. I think we have something special. I do feel that in this under this banner of really how do we make sure we really harness the promise of the intelligent age and avoid an age of fragmentation. This gathering of the foremost minds from around the world could not be more important. That's why we look forward to continuing that tradition and continuing to work with you on this network going forward. I wanted to just make sure, as you know, this summit is a lot of work, so I just wanted to recognize the colleagues that actually have been instrumental in bringing it together. Obviously, I cannot mention everyone, but I just wanted to recognize, number one, Saja Zahidi, my colleague, who is not here, but who's been heading the network, the Global Future Councils network, and Till Leopold, my colleague here, who has been steering it with Saja, and who is here. Jessica Wanger, who is behind a lot of the sessions that you see here, what we call public sessions, panels like this. Severin Podolak, who is heading our all operational component of the summit, and also a long-standing collaborator, Ruqayya Al-Blushi. Thank you so much, Ruqayya. You've been instrumental in not only putting together this summit, but overall for the partnership over the years. So thank you so much.